Hi everyone, I'm Ellen Kodadek, Executive and Artistic Director of Flushing Town Hall, and clearly I'm not in our gorgeous theater. Due to statewide health and safety regulations, Flushing Town Hall has been dark since the pandemic began in March, and we miss you, and I miss you. I miss talking with you before our global mashups, and hearing the sounds of the musicians float down to my office as they warm up on stage. I miss seeing hundreds of school kids' faces light up as they experience theater for the very first time. And I miss joining you in viewing new artwork in our gallery. Although we haven't been able to see each other in person, we've still stayed connected virtually through our Flushing Town Hall at Home programs. Maybe you're a jazz lover, listening to our monthly virtual Louis Armstrong Legacy Jazz Jams. Maybe you're a student, or a teacher, or a parent, virtually learning Colombian music, or Chinese dance, or pop-up books through our Global Arts for Global Kids program. Maybe you're an artist, learning from our expert staff how to write a grant and learn new online technologies. Or maybe you even move the furniture and dance during our virtual dance camps or Diwali festival. And maybe you even submitted your own artwork during our Call and Response Grief, Resiliency, and Hope outdoor community art exhibition. I could go on and on. In total, over the past months, Flushing Town Hall has offered 187 unique educational, arts and cultural events and experiences, each one allowing us to stay safe, stay connected, and weather the storm together. We've continued our work because we believe that the arts are essential in processing trauma, restoring joy, and building resiliency. We believe that by exploring arts and culture, we can interpret the human condition, make sense of a chaotic world, and be our authentic selves. Flushing Town Hall knows that you believe that too, because over 25,000 of you have joined us online from your living rooms throughout New York City. In Flushing, Forest Hills, Manhattan, Brooklyn, the Bronx, and Staten Island, in Long Island and upstate New York and Connecticut, and even from Italy, Australia, New Zealand, Germany, Guyana, and the UK. So thank you. Thank you to all the incredible jazz musicians who recorded music in their garages and submitted it to our jams. Thank you to all the artists who created new artwork for our outdoor exhibit. Thank you to all of our school students who made instruments and dance props from anything at hand to play alongside our master teaching artists. Thank you to our senior audiences who learned how to get on Zoom for the first time in order to stay connected to our community. Throughout all the challenges of the moment, you have been there with us. No artwork nor song can change the past, but we believe the arts can help us build resilient, diverse communities. For 42 years, Flushing Town Hall has honored, celebrated, and connected our diverse community through the arts. Together, we are rebuilding a more resilient, inspired, and courageous community. Please join us in this mission. Please make a gift today to Flushing Town Hall. Thank you.
Hello everyone, my name is Ya Yun. I'm the Chinese Project Director in Flushing Town Hall. 我是法拉盛文艺中心的雅云. Here on the screen with me is Yu Lin from Kunqu Society.
Hi everybody, good evening. I'm Yu Lin from Kunqu Society. 各位观众朋友，大家晚安，我是王玉林，海外昆曲社。 今天晚上非常欢迎大家跟我们一起来观赏今天的特别节目《游园惊梦》，张充和先生在美国的昆曲人生。Thank
you all for being here for the Kunqu in America, Memories of Miss 充和. I know there are many of you who tune in from all over the world, and I'm really happy that you are here with us. Yulin, Flushing Town Hall is really happy to work with Kunqu Society again. As we know that Flushing Town Hall's mission is to bring global arts to our global community. And we are thrilled that Kunqu Society has been a great partner to promote this beautiful art form, Kunqu, to the audience in the United States. And so we think that it's very important to make this program accessible so that we can bring people from different cultural backgrounds together and learn from each other.
对的，海外昆曲社也觉得非常高兴，我们能有机会跟市政厅再次合作，跟大家一起分享昆曲。根据我们的报名资料，我们知道今天的观众除了在美国本土东岸西岸的以外，美国本土的这些不同族裔、不同语言背景、不同文化的本土观众以外，我们还有一些观众是现在在中国、在香港、在台湾，也透过这个线上的活动跟我们同时在现场连线，与我们同在。我们觉得这是一个非常珍贵的时刻。那我们非常谢谢那市政厅这么多年来在推行这个多元文化上面做的持续的努力。我们相信经由这样的交流，彼此的认识，我们的世界当然会更美好。
And this year, because of COVID-19, Flushing Town Hall has offered virtual programs since March. But doing a virtual program is very different from doing a live performance. So as we are brainstorming what kind of program we can provide for our audience, we all think that it would be a good idea to take advantage of this online platform, which is, you know, to tell more stories. And of course, you know, we want to focus on stories about Quinchu. And since both of our organizations are located in America, we are most interested in telling stories of Quinchu in this country.
自从今年的春天，美国的疫情开始严重了以后，各地的现场舞台演出都停止了，都改成线上的活动。市政厅和海外昆曲社因应这样的改变，就有了今天这个节目的构思，就是我们来介绍美国的昆曲人物故事。今天我们要介绍的是有民国才女之称的曲人张充和女士。
Yeah, so we are so thrilled that we'll get to see a really rare portrait of Chungha's life in America and how she nurtured an art community here. So we are going to watch a video by Quinchu Society tonight. The video weaves together firsthand interviews of Chungha's children, friends, caretaker, Quinchu artists that she had worked with, as well as, you know, really rarely seen photos, videos of her performances.
崇和先生在1949年随着他的丈夫傅汉斯教授到美国来定居以后，他也把他最新的昆曲带到美国来了。他自己爱唱曲，天天唱曲，一直唱到他102岁过世的前两个星期都还在唱曲。他也教曲，他教他的丈夫，教他的女儿，教耶鲁的洋学生，教所有他认识的对昆曲有兴趣、有心要学习的朋友们。崇和老师呢，自己也组织了昆曲的讲座跟演出。在50、60年代，当时的美国没有专业演员，没有服装道具，没有乐队，没有化妆师，在这样一个四大皆空、样样皆无的情况下，崇和老师是怎么样去组织着在美国20几所大学的这30多场的讲座跟演出的呢？在我们的今天的节目里，我们采访到崇和老师的家人、他的儿女、他的管家、他的早期、晚期的学生，还有他在海外昆曲社相处了20多年的专业老师、老朋友们。我们希望从这些点点滴滴，从这些珍贵的照片、音频、视频里，可以勾勒出崇和老师他在美国的昆曲生活，以及昆曲如何在美国播种、萌芽的轨迹。
Yeah, as we all know, Chungha is a passionate Quinchu amateur devotee who emigrated to the U.S. in 1949. She kept practicing and promoting the art form for over 6 decades until 2 weeks before she passed away. During the 60s and the 80s, when there was really little exchange between US and China, she still traveled around the US to demonstrate and perform the art form in universities, but pretty much without the support of professional artists, you know, like professional actors or makeup artists. How did she do it? You will get to find, you know, get some idea in this video tonight. So following the video, we will have a live Q&A with several guests that appear in the videos and also members of Kunqu Society. So you'll get to understand more context from the live Q&A.
是，在我们的节目结束以后，我们会有一个现场的答问的环节。我们邀请到他的儿女，邀请到几位受访者，邀请到海外昆曲社的专业艺术家到现场来为我们回答问题。想问问题的观众，你可以在不管是在 YouTube 或者在 Zoom 的聊天室里面，把你的问题提出来，中文、英文都可以。
Yes, so if you have any questions for the Q&A, feel free to type them throughout the program in English and Chinese, both works. You just need to type them in a live chat in YouTube or Zoom, and then we'll pass them to our guest. So Yuling, who are our guests today?
好，现在我来介绍今天到我们跟我们现场连线的嘉宾。好，首先是冲和老师的家人。张崇和老师的儿子傅以元。
Here is Mr. Ian Frankel, Chong He's son. And I'm going to ask all the guests to turn on your camera and camera only, right?
Yeah. 对对，所以请各位嘉宾现在打开摄像镜头，所以观众们可以看到你们，不用打开麦克风。好，所以第一位是冲和老师的儿子傅以元先生 Ian， 第二位是冲和老师的女儿傅以模。
And then we have Miss Emma Frankel, Chongher's daughter.
嗯哼，好，在 Emma 后面坐着的，我想是冲和老师的女婿 David， 对吧？
So now sitting behind Emma is David, who is Emma's husband.
好，下一位是跟随冲和老师最久的学生，也是海外昆曲社的前任社长陈安娜女士。
Anna Wu, former president of Kunqu Society.
海外昆曲社前任副社长。艺术总监尹继芳老师
Miss Ji Fang Yin, former vice president and artistic director.
海外昆曲社现任艺术总监程明老师
Mr. Min Chen, artistic director.
海外昆曲社现任音乐总监周明老师
Mr. Min Zhou, music director.
接下来要介绍几位都是著名的昆曲演员，是我们海外昆曲社的驻社艺术家，也是我们传习班的老师，文富林老师跟徐菊光老师。
Mr. and Mrs. Fu Lin Wen and Ju Gong Xu.
是，好，蔡清宁老师跟史杰华老师。
And we have Mr. and Mrs. Qinglin Cai and Jie Hua Shi.
昆曲社前任的艺术总监吴德章老师。
Mr. De Zhang Wu.
昆曲社殷海怡老师。
Miss Hai Yin, Hai Yi Yin. And these are well-known Kunqu performers who are the resident artists of Kunqu Society and teachers of the Kunqu Workshop.
对。我们今天还特别请到了冲和老师晚年的管家，最了解他日常作息的吴里流先生。
And we have Li Liu Wu, who was the caretaker of 冲和。
海外昆曲社社长张东新教授。
Professor 东新 Chang, President of Kunqu Society。
海外昆曲社传习班主任辛玉荣女士。
Ms. Yu Rongxin, Director of the Kunqu Workshop.
Hawaii Kunqu 社副社长, 郑崇德先生.
Mr. Ted Tan, Vice President of Kunqu Society.
是的, 这几位嘉宾都会在答问的环节里面跟我们现场观众在一起, 所以想问问题的观众, 我们现在有很好的嘉宾等着你们, 可以满足大家的好奇心。
Yeah, we can answer all of your questions. So we really appreciate all the guests making their appearance with us today. I also want to thank donors who make the event possible. National Endowment for the Arts, 美国国家文艺基金会, New York State Council on the Arts, with the support of Governor Andrew Cuomo and New York State Legislature, 纽约州政府, New York City Department of Cultural Affairs, 纽约市文化局, Howard Gilman Foundation, Ben Fox and Leslie R. Samuels Foundation, Booth Ferris Foundation, and we have Taiwan Glow Foundation, 甘台琳女士, 启阳基金会, Veronica Tang, 曾翁若梅女士, Andy Leeting at Compass, Shandong Association, Shandong Tongxianghui, Shanghai Commercial Bank, Shanghai Shangye Yinhang. Thank you so much for all the support.
谢谢以上的捐助单位。 法拉盛市政厅和海外昆曲社都不是盈利机构，要不是这些单位以及关心艺术文化的朋友们无私的捐助跟帮助，我们没有办法持续提供高质量的文艺活动给大家。所以谢谢他们。好，那么下面就请大家开始观赏今天的节目《游园惊梦》，张崇和在美国的昆曲人生。
And now, please enjoy the program by Kunqu Society, Kunqu in America, Memories of Ms. Chong He Chang Franco.
Zhang Chonghe was born in 1913 to a prestigious family. When she was 8 months old, Chonghe was adopted by her grand aunt. She was raised in Chang family's hometown of Hefei, away from her parents and siblings. Chonghe had a traditional Chinese education, learned classic texts like Shi Ji, Han Shu, Zuo Zhuan, and Shi Jing. She was a vivid reader from her early ages. In her grandfather's library, she read 20 drama from Ming and Qing dynasties, such as Peony Pavilion, Peach Blossom Fan, and quite enjoyed the prose and verse. Her grand aunt passed away when Chonghe was 17. She went back to Suzhou to live with her father, stepmother, and brothers.
回到苏州以后, 父亲带他去看昆曲, 他从来不知道昆曲是什么, 可是到了昆曲的表演的时候, 他说, 他们唱什么, 我都知道耶, 他们唱词我都知道耶, 我知道他的这个故事耶。 后来他爸爸就说, 你怎么知道? 他说他小时候在苏州母, 祖父的小书房里面又有一个清代南戏，他就是把收了这个《牡丹亭》啊，这些桃花扇啊，从何不知道，他以为是故事书，他就把它一本一本的都钻拿出来看啊，觉得写得好的不得了，故事又这么好，所以他会背，他不知道能唱。 到那时候坐在昆曲表演，他坐在台下，他说：“我知道他们唱的是什么。”The
incident opened a new world to Chonghe. She immediately immersed herself in the art of Kunqu. She learned Kunqu singing and movements from the famous performers Shen Chuanzhi and Zhang Chuanfang. A well-known flutist taught her Kunqu flute. According to elder sister Yuan He, Chonghe was obsessed with Kunqu. Oftentimes, she practiced day and night. Kunqu accompanied her through war, separation, reunion, falling in love, getting married, and coming to America. When they first came to the United States, Chonghe and her husband Hans Frankel lived in California for 12 years. In 1961, Hans was appointed by the Department of East Asian Studies at Yale University. The family moved to North Haven, Connecticut. Chonghe never stopped singing and practicing Kunqu. In their Connecticut home, she would invite students and friends over to have singing gatherings.
Well, I remember when they would have, you know, like Mrs. Zhang, Anna, Wang Dingyi, and then sometimes some other people, they would have a practice. Practice slash, you know, a jam, and it always involved lots of good food. It was fun. I really enjoyed that, and especially when I was younger, because, you know, the party would go on till who knows when, and instead of me having to go to bed early, I could stay up, you know, midnight or later. You know, it was kind of neat. It was so long ago, you know, and I still remember them so fondly.
那冲和老师当时在耶鲁的艺术系教授书法，至于昆曲呢，他在自己家里教授昆曲，所以在耶鲁来来去去的很多学者都跟冲和老师跟昆曲产生了关系。冲和老师把自己家的这个小曲剧就取了一个名字，叫做野鲁曲社。野鲁，它的谐音是耶鲁，耶鲁大学。但是它用的字很雅，这个野是就是这个野无风雨，野无晴这个野。鲁呢是这个房舍结庐在人境而无居马喧的这个鲁。所以它用的这两个字野鲁，它的意思是也可为鲁，就是New Haven, 耶鲁这块地方也可以是个家。他跟汉斯结婚以后，很快的因为局势变化，很快就到美国来了。所以他离开了中国，把中国的这么多背景、爱好、关系，各样各样的中国，等于说都留在49年。但是他一直随身携带着的两件很重要的事，一个是书法，一个就是昆曲。
After Chonghe passed away, some of her students at Yale decided to keep Ye Lu going. They continued to bring in members and invited friends of Ye Lu for singing gatherings. They also supported many country events in Yale over the years. Chunghe was also involved in the creation of the Kunqu Society.
1988年10月，那个时候，浙江昆曲团的副团长汪世瑜，有人就是在加州有两个大学请他来演讲示范。那个时候，张元和已经在加州，住在加州。他写信给我，他说：“你们那边能不能够找一些昆曲的曲友帮忙，帮汪世瑜老师安排最少一次演出，能有两次更好。”他给我写信，我接到他的信以后就打电话找王定一，他们当然都知道了，王希一，所以我就跟他们打电话，然后也告诉这个陈福燕，因为陈福燕是老师的学生嘛，我说我们来办一个真正的昆曲的演员的演习，好不好？大家都说好啊，好啊，所以非常热心，大家就马上行动起来。总共演了三场戏，一场在哥大，第二场是在钱宁纳的图书馆，第三场是在这个中国城的华埠遵义县初中。12月18号。他要回去了，那么，我们大家就说我们要为他践行。陈飞燕说到我家来，我家地方大，他可以表演，所以就约了我们。他那时候有四个嘉宾，我们都是普通朋友，就是冲和、汉斯、汪世瑜、黄美云三个。所以我说汪老师，你的艺术，就只要看过你的艺术的人，就对昆曲忘不了了。我说我们对昆曲有信心了。我说我们的人都在这儿，我们能不能够就成立？不是我说，还有别人的七嘴八舌，就说我们能不能成立一个昆曲社？大家说好啊好啊，我们来试，我们试试看，就成立了。就是那一天，12月18号。
Since then, Chunghe had been a close friend to many society members. She came to Kunqu Society's events almost every year. The resident artists and members of the society would visit Chunghe several times a year. Kunqu was part of her life. Chunghe never stopped singing. She practiced almost every day. When asked about the memories of their mother's continuous practice of Kunqu,
it's so hard to say when you're growing up with it, because that's just what we did. Because I can't imagine what it would be like without it, because
that's just normal. It was just normal operating procedure.
Yeah.
You know? Cool. You didn't think about it. It was just
what we did.
In her later years, Chunghe sang all day long, with the exception of the time she practiced calligraphy. The tune of her singing lasted until 2 weeks before her passing. We can hardly find Chunghe's Kunqu recordings in her younger days. In 2004, Chen Anna and Ying Jifang, then president and artistic director of the Kunqu Society, produced an album, Chunghe Chang's 16 Kunqu Arias, in Suzhou. She was 91 years old.
张老师的唱的别具一格，我对他的印象最深的就是他的唱的行腔的连贯性，他的行腔很自然，很自如，很圆润，他不会断， 比如说我们举个例子啊，我听过他唱过《寻梦》，就是那个当当啊当啦当啦，你那米算米了多来多来多来多谁了？他有这么一段，结果他是一气呵成，结果给我感觉就是好像水银泻地呀、啊。
像我跟这个张充和吹的时候，他的谱，我吹帮他吹的谱，通常有另外全部上面做了笔记，嗯。然后他另外一个，精彩的地方，比如说像《游园》里面，良辰美景奈何天，呀，他奈何两个字，唱的走音，我当时他开始唱的时候。我开始帮他吹，他是规规矩矩唱，后来吹多了以后，他唱走音，他没有跟我讲，我听出来了，我一听，哎呀，这样子好啊，把奈何那个味道弄出来，而且整个稍微慢一点，奈何天，就把那个奈何味道弄出来。如果你是完全规规矩矩唱，那个味道就没了。另外还有前面墨揣菱花偷人半面，这个是汤显祖精彩的地方。他不说杜丽娘去照镜子，他镜子偷了我半个脸去。但是以前呢，这个小姐对这些事情呢，好像自己太顾重自己的容貌，这个没有大家闺秀呀，所以很害羞。所以张充和唱的时候，偷人半面音特别低，收低了唱。那前面刚好这个墨揣菱花墨揣两个字高音呀，就很强，到突然半面整个声音小下来，就把那个很不好意思害羞的味道弄出来，所以这种地方真的我只有跟他才学得到，别人没有这个境界。我有一次这个在把他排戏的时候，我跟他伴奏游园，这个我看是哪里啊，烟丝最软呀的时候，结果这个里面我以前吹的都是用瘦腔，结果张充和唱的是用叠腔，所以我就跟张充和讲，我说，哎，我说这个地方是不是瘦腔比较好听呀，我觉得瘦腔比较好听，他说对，但是你看我的身段，一看身段，他这个三下是倒退三步，身段跟他整个合上去了。我那时候才开始真的理解到，为什么这个腔跟身段是合的。这个不是说你要你高兴怎么唱就怎么唱，呀。
Once 充和 was on stage, she became the character in the play.She put all her emotions in.
中和阿姨她最好的地方就是说，她自己可以用她自己的感觉把她加到身段里面去。她的身段如果照一些专业人来看并不一定很标准，但 并不妨害她的诠释。她诠释出来的东西就是有内容在里面。可是就跟刚刚丁仪讲的一样，很难学，这个东西就很非常难学。就像他的刺虎最后 那段朝天子，那段身段好的不得了，可是呢跟一般的身段都不一样，然后他又把 哭头跟枪合在一起，像引到黄阳台这个台子，就是利用哭头把它哭出来的。那个本身是一个手枪，刚好就用哭头把它哭出来。对他的东西，我最大一个感觉就是这样。看，你要第一个，你自己要有基础，你才看得懂。而看得懂，不见得学得到。我经过一个人转介讲，这已经是。这个就已经失真了，所以这东西很难，就是这个问题，就只有自己欣赏。所以我们是看过他很多精彩的地方，但是呢，你说真的要我讲出来，我讲不出来。
Was it really difficult to learn from Chonghe? Many of her students said so. Her first student might be her husband Hans. At first, Chonghe tried to teach him singing, but Hans didn't sing very well. She then taught him how to play drums. So ever since, for a lot of country gatherings, Hans played a drum.
And I studied Kunqi with her from the age of 4 until I left for college when I was 18. Every morning we would practice. She would teach me line by line, like one phrase at a time. And in the morning we would sing together, or I would practice while she was brushing my hair and getting me ready for school. And then after school, we would practice some more, and she would have 100, no, I exaggerate, maybe 50 toothpicks, and she would move one every time I sang the phrase so that she would know that I practiced 50 times until I learned the piece in its entirety. And then she would slowly add on learning to do the dances. We would practice in the living room. And I remember the rug had a round center. So we would go around and around and around. So the rug in the living room was our stage.
To assist Emma's study, Chonghe copied a few musical score sheets using Gongchi notation in longhand. Emma learned singing, stage speech, and movements for a stroll in the garden, in the classroom, and a sifan. Over the years, Chonghe taught many students. Some of them knew nothing about Kunqi when they started. Li Liuwu, Chonghe's caretaker in her later years, was also a student of hers. He said, as long as you were willing to learn, Chonghe would teach. However, once Chonghe took someone in, she was rather a strict teacher.
2010年的时候, 有一位昆曲的朋友, 邀请我到纽约去看他的演出。 那天呢，我就坐在观众席的第一排。当天演出的游园惊梦，让我觉得怎么这么美。就在一两个星期以后，有一天我到饭馆吃饭，碰到冲和先生，我就跟张先生说，这两个星期来，我一直脑中还有那些音乐那些画面。那张先生听了以后非常的高兴，张先生说：“是啊，是啊，是啊。” 昆曲是美的，我每个星期六都开放唱曲，你星期六来我家吧。我说我什么都不会，他说你学了就会了，你唱了就会了。因为我跟张先生学曲的时候，张先生已经是近百岁的高龄了，身体状况，那个吐气什么都不似当年，但是他还是 非常非常的用心的教我怎么用气，我印象最深的是，有一天他就看着我说：“你过来。”我就战战兢兢的过去，然后他就把我的手拉过去放在他的腹部下腹部，然后说：“我现在唱，你感觉一下。”然后我想他那天唱的可能是琴挑吧，那个长青短青，那个用很多气的。然后他就要我把手右手放在他的下腹部，也就是丹田的地方。然后他说：“我没办法告诉你怎么发声，因为每个人不一样。但是你去感觉我是怎么用气的，我的感觉就是，他的丹田就是。” 鼓起收，鼓收，然后随着那个唱的气息长短， 收放，给我的印象非常非常的深刻。
It took Yulin a month just to learn one verse from a stroll in the garden. Similarly, Chunghe trained her caretaker, Xiaowu, from ground zero. Xiaowu learned singing first. It took him 2 weeks, every single day, to learn the first stanza from finding a portrait correctly. Later,Xiaowu started to learn the flute, again, practicing from dawn to dusk. Learning the flute was much smoother for him, because he was used to Chunghe's tunes. Since then, he played the flute when Chunghe sang. Chen Anna studied with Chunghe for the longest time.She's also one of the advanced students. Anna started to learn Kunqu in her college. She also plays the flute. Her learning experience was very different from Yulin and Xiaowu.
要他教曲的是，因为我不需要知道这个宫曲谱，我会看谱，我基本的腔调也知道。所以他是要告诉我的是说运腔的办法，运怎么运腔，哪里轻哪里重，啊，还有呢，就是说怎么把感情放进去。
王定一 ，another student of Chunghe's, studied Kunqu since childhood. He learned Kunqu from his aunt Xu Wenpei, a famous Kunqu artist for 5 years in Taiwan.He met Chunghe when she visited Taiwan. Later, he came to the U.S. for graduate school.
1968年夏天，我决定转学到东部，到 New Hampshire 的Dartmouth College. Yeah. 结果那一边离这个张阿姨住的地方，她是在 Yale, Connecticut. Yeah. 这个总共开车不过两个多小时，所以我到了那边以后，有一个 weekend 有空，我就打电话给他，说我过来方不方便啊？他说开心的不得了，你过来过来，赶快过来。所以我就坐了这个 Greyhound 过去，就到他家里。到他家里以后，马上他就叫我拿出笛子来就唱。所以从1968年的夏天到1971年夏天我结婚，总共3年，几乎每一个月我都去1到2次到他家里去。而且到他家里去，我们唱曲子的性质非常好，常常是从早上吃完早饭10点钟开始，一直唱到晚上10点，这个中间大概就是两顿饭，这个休息一下。
Before he met Chunghe, Mr. Wang was already very good at the flute.
然后另外像以前，我的笛子因为比较满，吹的我气比较足，我吹的比较满，这个所以不会收。强的音我可以唱的，其实吹笛子是强音容易吹啊，低音小声难吹啊，是这个就不太会收。结果他就尤其介绍给我是那个秦条的朝阳歌第三段，你是个天生俊生呀，那时候就说是他把里面有的地方要强，有的地方又收得很软很弱。整个味道，哎呀，那一唱就发现整个味道跟原来完全不一样，呀，跟你这个看了谱这样唱完全不一样，呀，所以这个就是他真正他最精彩的地方。这个当然这边讲到就是吹笛子了，唱昆曲这些，就是他给我最大启发就是，因为他的张通的书法好嘛，对，这个所以最大启发就是这个他把。书法上的那个诀窍呀交给我，他说这个初学分部写字，初学分部怎么排安排，务求平整，你规规矩矩写呀，既得平整已经规规矩矩会了，务追显绝，里面要开始耍花样呀，不再规规矩矩写，即使是楷书你中间还是可以耍花样，对。 既得显觉，复归平正，复归平整，呀，就说这下看山又是山了，看水又是水了，
是，
所以这个给我的这个，就说理解方面非常非常大，所以后来很多我的尤其吹笛子方面，我腔越来越简单，甚至于有一些原来谱上面像苏禄曲谱上面有一些苏禄曲谱，写的是我舅舅写的，呀，这个有些腔，我到后来吹的时候都把它省掉了，呀，因为发现哎，省掉以后那个味道更好，啊，这个当然每个人的感触不一样，但是基本上讲，你必须要有这一层的领悟，才能够到那个境界，要不然永远到不了那个境界。所以我始终觉得，我真正跟他学到的，不只是说词跟那个腔的怎么合，甚至于跟身段怎么合，他真正教给我的是什么？是昆曲的魂，这个才是真正艺术最高的境界呀。他这种地方真，而且他自己一直在改进。
冲和 promoted 昆曲 on stage actively between 1950 and 1986 in the United States. She introduced the literature and art of 昆曲 to academic and cultural circles.
所以冲和到美国来，他都是在文化机构、大学里面讲课。那么他的英文当然，不能够做很好的演讲。可是汉斯每一次是汉斯第一个上台，把昆曲的这个历史简短的历史，然后昆曲的文学美、昆曲的艺术美，配合要演的节目，它的内容是什么？那么先介绍一下，介绍了以后，然后汉那个春和才上去演戏，最起先只有他一个人。后来他的女儿也学了嘛，所以他们就变成两个人。
When 春和 came to the U.S., she brought with her a couple of costumes and a few bamboo flutes. When she needed to perform on stage, she found herself without enough costumes, headgear, props, or musical instruments. So she made them by herself.From scratch.
You know, the preparation for performances, I remember her making her costume. We had we lived in a pretty large house, and the dining room was huge, and it had a very large table. And she would set up, you know, cutting cloths, all the materials needed to make costumes. It would just take up that whole giant table. And she would make from nothing.Into the super, you know, elaborate Quincy costumes and had to make, I guess, several for every performance because of the different, performance.
This is just in our home. That's our living room. So that's the costume the one that she's wearing, she brought with her from China.The one that I'm wearing, she made. So it's all sequins and trim that we bought at the fabric store. And the headdresses she made out of wire, imitation pearls, sequins, and just trim. My hair, there's no pictures on my back.My hair was all the way down to my waist, so she didn't have to make wigs. But for the makeup on the sides, that's electrical tape. electric tape, yeah. And I don't have this fan, but I still have the round fan that she made for me. And again, the edges and the handle are electrical tape. She was very creative, very resourceful.
老师，那个就是那时候不晓得他在耶鲁不晓得演出什么，因为我那时候戴的那个下山的服装有一套，他就问我借了一个道箍巾。他还给我的时候，他就说：“哎呀，我给你做了一个东西，我想做什么东西啊？那个他说我给你做了一个缝，就在你的道箍巾上面弄了一个缝，这个是个道箍巾，你看这个缝是张老师自己做的。” 他怎么他就是用那个软签丝啊，就做出了这个这么一个缝做上去以后，在那我这个道箍巾就漂亮多了。本来这个就平平的嘛，那个就是张老师给我做的这个东西，这个就是也是一个珍贵的一个纪念品了。我就现在就很珍贵的把它保存起来了，就是
besides costumes, props, and headgear. The most ingenious item she ever made was flute. She tried various materials, from the traditional bamboo stems to aluminum and plastic pipes.
In the basement, she would set up her flute factory. She would have pieces of pipe that she would pick up either buying it or going to places that she knows, you know, would have scrap pipe, and she would come home with a piece of pipe, maybe, you know, three, you know, the length of a, approximately the length of a flute. She would cut it down to size. She had a little table down there with a vise, and then she had this drilling machine. It was sort of like a large scale Dremel type tool. And then she would mark out the pipe, cut it to the right distance, take a felt marker, put where she wanted the holes. She would drill the holes. Smooth over the holes so they weren't sharp. She would test it out. She would figure out where she had to put, I guess there was a plug on each end or on one end and all that. And then to get the flute to sound the right tone, remember, she would take thread and wrap it, maybe like half-inch wide pieces or half-inch wide wraps of thread, maybe five, six, eight places on that flute to get the tone just the way she wanted. And then she would take nail polish, the clear nail polish, and put it over the thread so it stayed there and didn't deteriorate. So, and you know, that was before there was you know, YouTube videos on how to make your own quinchy flute. That was I don't think there was any books on it. I mean, she just did it, and those flutes are still around. I know she gave one to Mr. Wu, Liliu Wu, and I'm sure Emma has some. They're still there.
Yeah, so my mother practiced with all different kinds of materials. She made flutes out of copper, aluminum, steel, plastic. She experimented with dyeing flutes different colors. She grew her own bamboo. We had a bamboo grove in the backyard, and she would cut down the bamboo, dry it, dye it. Sometimes she would buy bamboo from New York or have it sent from China. But this is one of the flutes. And we would wrap the thread around the hole, around the flute, and then paint it with clear nail polish. So this is where you blow in the air. And then this hole has membrane over it that vibrates. But back in 1966 or 69, you couldn't just go to the store and buy the membranes that, or buy the material that covers the membranes. So we would take onions and gently peel them apart and take the membrane between the layers and dry it out on wax paper and then attach it to the flute to cover that hole.
Some of the aluminum and plastic flutes are still being used by Xiao Wu when the Yelu Kunchu Club has singing gatherings.
They did an addition to the house. So my mom had her own office study area. And this was, it was like very, very, you know, I had like the newer windows, I guess, the double thick windows, whatever they were, and it was all insulated nice. So it was very, very quiet. And in that room, that's where mom had, she had like some state-of-the-art recording equipment. I mean, some very expensive reel-to-reel stuff. I remember it wasn't stuff you could just go to someplace and buy. She had to go, I think she had to go to New York to some specialty commercial recording artist place. I remember, I mean, back in the day, I remember Ampex was a big company. And, you know, if the commercial model was, you know, the 100 series, she had like the 800 series. And I remember her talking about how, you know, it was really, really expensive. And but it was really nice. And I remember she would spend like a long time deciding, like before she recorded anything, where she was going to put all the microphones in the house. Do you remember that?
Oh, yeah, we found reels and reels of reel-to-reel audio tape. But by the time we found them, when we were cleaning out the house, they were so degraded that we couldn't restore them.
当然我第一次可以替他伴奏，但是呢，那时候也就只有我一根笛子。 没有古板，所以古板怎么办呢？像他演游园，我就把那个梅兰芳跟那个严跟于正飞的跟严慧珠的游园，我就把那个古板录音带录下来，摆到旁边，请其他的曲友到时候按一下古板出来，那个惨在哪里？你是拿脚去对古板啊，不是古板来对你脚啊？因为这个我自己尝过的苦头。我跟张聪和有一次在这个 Princeton 演《惊梦》，结果他就要我演小生，对，结果这个古板就是这样子，我们两个人用脚来对这个古板，不是古板来对脚，所以唱得很辛苦。
First one was when I was 8 years old in St. Louis. She was invited by departments of ethnomusicology. We performed at Yale, St. Louis, Wisconsin, and California. Remember, there was one performance where, how do I say this? We went off the script. We like made a mistake, so we improvised. Yes, we were just sort of like made something up and went back to the spot where we picked up.
Okay.
我记得最清楚的是，在纽约的叫我们叫做北平原 White Plains 这个大学里面有一个讲座，秋和化了妆，我也化了妆，他姐姐也化了妆，我们两个轮流吹笛子，吹笛子之后，我们是穿着戏服吹的。 打鼓板的是汉斯，汉斯很早就学会了打鼓板，所以汉斯在打鼓板。我在那里演那个《吹风毛铃》《扎走叉》，在演那个戏的时候，冲和是穿着全副的服装，这个戏装在那里吹笛子。他演的时候是我吹笛子，都在舞台上。
In 1965. Professor A.C. Scott from University of Wisconsin invited Chonghe to give a month-long lecture teaching and demonstrating Sifan, longing for the mundane world. Scott later wrote an important book on two traditional Kunshu plays. One of them was Sifan, based on Chonghe's lecture and a performance. Chonghe was the actor, musician, makeup artist, stage manager, and producer, all in one. In short, she was a one-woman Kunshu factory. Between 1953 and 1986, she gave 35 performances and lectures in more than 20 institutes in 12 states across the U.S., the most being in Connecticut, California, and New York.
Yeah, I mean, you know, growing up with my mom, you know, Kunshu was a huge thing, but as well as her calligraphy and so many other things. And one of the things I was, you know, she wasn't just all Kunshu all the time. She was also a good mom, a good cook. She her garden was amazing. The vegetables, you know, that she grew. You know, everybody in the neighborhood liked her. I mean, she was busy doing other things too, but the other things that she did, she was kind of really good at. And, you know, like I was saying before, like every one of us here is very good at one thing for sure. And then probably a couple other things we're very good at, but not an expert at. But my mom appeared, she was, you know, near expert level in quite a few disciplines, you know, and a lot of it was even later, because she came from, you know, when she was a young person, when she was in China, like kind of a family of privilege. And when she came to the United States, she had to basically start from ground zero. I mean, she didn't know how to cook. She didn't know how to do any of that. And she became, you know, so much of that she just did. And it was really kind of amazing. And like, you know, as kids, we didn't, you know, she never really told us that. She never told us that. And we just assumed, you know, sort of like, that's just the way everything is. You know, that's normal. We didn't know. And you know, they were both my mom and dad, they were very modest. They never said, hey, you know, just so you know, like, we're really good at this. No, they weren't like that. And they were both very special people. And
yeah, when we went to Seattle, so her friend Mimi, part of the grand reopening of the Seattle Asian Art Museum, featured my mother's calligraphy, the calligraphy of her teacher and her colleagues, as well as a small exhibit about the Kunshu. She showed that, do you remember that beautiful scarlet robe with the gold thread embroidery? And then the blue and white costume were also on display. And I asked Mimi, so is there going to be like a reception or something? She's like, yeah, we're going to have some people over and there's going to be like some wine and snacks. And we got there. There was skylights. What do you call them? Klieg lights in the sky. There were hundreds.
Like a Hollywood opening. It's like a Hollywood opening.
Hundreds of people. And then Ian and I were almost like my mother's bodyguards, like protecting her from all these people who were trying to get close to her. And then in the speech in the auditorium, Mimi said, you know, Zhang Chongho is one of the 20th century greatest calligraphers and probably the greatest living female calligrapher. And Ian and I were on either side of my mother, and we looked at each other and said, Mom? And I don't think we knew just how intelligent and creative and resourceful she was at the time, because, you know, it's just Mom.
Yes.
She loved her grandchildren. Do you remember this picture yet?
Mom was, I think, 98 in that picture.
Yeah.
我的感觉呢，聪和老师是一个非常谦和的老太太，很亲切，很慈祥，很谦和，虚怀若谷。因为我记得我第一次参加曲艺会，聪和老师，认识了以后，他跟我讲的第一句话，我到现在记忆犹新，有二十多年了吧。他第一句话是：“我不懂昆曲。”
冲和昌 Frankel dedicated herself to Kunqu, like she described it in a poem. She went on a lifelong journey accompanied by Kunqu. Nonetheless, she still says, I don't know Kunqu.
谢谢大家跟我们一起聆听张冲和昆曲的故事。冲和老师说他不懂昆曲，我想除了他的虚怀若谷以外，其实还有一层含义，是艺术是无止境的，而冲和老师对昆曲艺术的追求也是无止境的，所以他觉得永远学不完，永远 懂得不够.
Yes, Zhonghe was being humble when she said, I don't know anything about Kunqu. And she also meant that there's no end to learning about Kunqu art. Yulin, I heard there's a flute music, throughout the video. Can you tell us a little bit more about the music?
是在影片的背景音乐里面，大家一直听到有一段笛音吹奏各种不同的曲牌，那是冲和老师自己吹奏的笛子。那我们听到的多半都是《牡丹亭》里面的几个曲牌，有《游园》，有《惊梦》。当然，我不知道是哪一支笛子，也许就是他做的塑料笛或者是铝笛子，但是我想大家都听出了这个古朴之味。
So the flute music were played by Chonghe herself, and one of the theme song was from Pini Pavilion, and it's hard to tell which flute that she made. She used to play the songs, but that was really rare that we had the recording. So talking about that, what about the archival video, which I recognize was from Pini Pavilion? Can you talk a little bit about that video?
是，刚才也有观众朋友问那个录像里头的杜丽娘是谁，那就是我们的张充和老师。好，那是1986年为了庆祝汤显祖逝世350周年的时候，充和老师回到中国去，在北京昆研社跟北京昆研社的欧阳启明老师还有他的姐姐一起演了《游园惊梦》。当时充和老师是73岁，那是他最后一次粉墨登台。
Wow, so that was also a real video from 1986 when Chong He was performing in Beijing. At that point, she was 73 years old, and that was also her last time performing on stage with full costume and makeup. Yulin, can you tell us a little bit more about any other recording that was, you know, by Chong He?
是，其实在影片中大家还听到一段曲的唱段，就是王先生谈到那个充和老师唱刺虎灯那个时候，那个是充和老师刺虎的唱段，朝天子的唱段。然后这个唱段是充和老师在91岁的时候录制的，他录在张充和昆曲16首里头。
Yeah, so in the video, we also incorporate her singing of, I believe the translation is assassinating the general. This was also sang by Chong He herself when she was 91 years old. She recorded an album called 16 Kunqu Arias by Chong He Chang at that year.
对，还有最后的时候结束的那个视频，充和老师 唱《朝元歌》的那个视频，那是他98岁生日的时候，海外昆曲社到 New Haven 去给他庆生，当时留下来的记录。
Yeah, so at the very end, when you see Chong He was singing and I think the credit was rolling, that was when she was celebrating her 98 years old birthday. And the Kunqu Society threw a birthday party for her. And that was the recording from then. Mm-hmm. So that was a fascinating video. I know that there's so much work that goes into it. And so can you tell us a little bit about, you know, what was the process, how many people were interviewed and involved in terms of putting the videos together?
是的，为了制作这个影片，我们一共采访访问了15位这个跟充和老师有关的这些朋友们。我们的录像录影的这些资料大约有20多个小时，那工作时数超过100个小时。那比较特别的是，我们昆曲社没有专业人员，所以制作小组都是义工，大家都是在课余工作之余或者忙完孩子忙完家事以后，利用周末跟晚上的时间做的。
Wow, so the Kunqu Society interviewed 15 people and the raw material itself was about 20 hours long. And of course, you know, more than hundreds of hours goes into process all the materials and editing. I'm really impressed by what the members of Kunqu Society accomplished. And this was also the first time the Kunqu Society trying to produce a video project, and this is really just great. You know, one thing also that's impressive is all the members use their evenings and weekends, you know, because everybody has 9-to-5 jobs, you know, they use their leisure time to put the video together.
这是我们海外昆曲社第一次尝试制作这样的节目，很明显有很多不足之处，但是我们的能力有限，我们对充和老师的怀念跟敬意却是无穷的，所以我们仅以此片纪念充和老师，也纪念他走过的昆曲岁月。
Well, just like Chong He, this video was really handmade by the Kunqu Society members. And I think this is a very proper way to pay tribute to Chonghe.
好，下面是我们现场的提问时间，所以观众朋友们如果想问什么问题，你可以在我们的聊天室留言，然后我们会请我们现场的嘉宾为您解答。现在我看到一个问题，有观众朋友问，他说今天冲和先生的节目很精彩，第一次知道冲和先生关于昆曲的演唱教学和他的昆曲生活，这些资料很珍贵，不知道海外昆曲社还有没有其他纪念冲和先生的节目和活动。这个问题我想我们可以请昆曲社的艺术总监陈明老师回答，所以这个雅云，请你翻译一下这个问题。
Sure, yeah. The question was, that was a great celebration of Chonghe's life. Is there any other programs about Chonghe coming up or in the past organized by Kunqu Society? Mr. Chen will answer the question.
好，片子看完了，看得也很激动。那也很谢谢刚才这位观众所提的问题。我的理解是我们过去有做冲和先生的节目，今年也有，那我们在明年后年甚至大后年我们还是一定会做的。
Yeah, Kunqu Society has done several gatherings to celebrate Chonghe's life last year, this year, and of course for sure in the future. Yeah, and I see that all our guest is still, you know, not on the screen. You know, do you want to turn on your microphone and camera so that we can all see your face?
是，那么冲和老师在生前一直不遗余力的支持我们的曲社。那我觉得很好奇，就是不知道他的儿女对这件事情有没有要补充的。雅云能不能帮我们问一下他的儿子，就是关于冲和老师跟曲社的关系，还有对曲社的支持这一部分。
我本来要说这个问题的，玉林帮我说了，很好。
Yeah, sure. So this question is actually for Ian and Emma. We learned that your mother had asked you to keep involved in Kunqu Society's events, activities. Can you both talk a little bit about that? And from your observation, what was the relationship between your mother and the Kunqu Society? Either Ian or Emma.
Go ahead, Emma. Well, I don't know if Emma's there. I could just say that had very little to do with Quincy. I had literally almost zero to do with it. I enjoyed going away on trips. It was fun to be in a different auditorium or stage theater while they were performing. I got to run around and have fun while Emma and my mom and Anna and Wang Dingyi and my Dai, my aunt, did all the work. So you really, Emma's the one to answer the question better than me.
I'm sorry, can you repeat the question? I didn't hear it.
Okay, yeah, maybe let me translate what Ian said very briefly. I think Ian was talking, in Chinese, right? Yeah. Ian 他大部分是在说他小时候记得就是有跟妈妈一起出去演过，但是他那个时候比较调皮，就是跑来跑去，然后通常就是姐姐Emma 就是还有跟其他的叔叔阿姨在忙演出的事情，所以 Ian 要请 Emma 来回答这个问题。那 Emma, let me repeat the question again. We had heard that your mother had asked you to keep involved with the Kunqu Society after she passed away. We just wanted to know, like, whether, you know, what you remember about that, and from your observation, what was the relationship between your mother and the Kunqu Society?
the Quenchy Society was her life. I mean, after, you know, Ian and I moved out, she spent hours and hours a day practicing her calligraphy, but also, you know, also keeping in touch with the members of the Quenchy Society. Many times when I live in Chicago now, but whenever my two sons and I would come home to see grandma, there were always Quenchy Society people coming over, singing, practicing, enjoying her cooking. She was very, very active in the Quenchy Society, and she loved it. It was her life.
Yeah, so Emma said, Emma 说呢，昆曲跟曲社就是真的是她妈妈的生命。Ian 跟Emma就是成年之后搬走了以后，老师他天天就是把很多时间花在练书法上面。那Ian 跟 Emma 也一直有跟曲社的人有联络。那他Emma 他自己目前是住在芝加哥，那之前呢会跟孩子回家看奶奶。那每次回去看奶奶，除了煮奶奶吃的东西之外，他们都记得就是家里总是会有曲社的人一边就是跟他在一起练习，或者是有不同的一些聚会所以就是一直都有联络。
是，冲和老师是曲社的顾问，从第一天开始，那他的精神也就是带着我们曲社往前走。好，现在还有人问到，他说身在美国，这是在海外，有没有机会学习昆曲？能怎么学习昆曲呢？我觉得这个问题可以请昆曲社海外昆曲社的传习班的主任辛玉荣来回答。
So the next question is, if I want to learn Quenchy in the U.S., where can I go? Yurong is going to answer the question.
是，海外昆曲社一直有办昆曲传习班。在疫情之前，我们是在法拉盛高中每周六举办传习班，由昆曲社驻社艺术家们教授身段、唱曲还有笛子。当然现在在疫情期间我们转为网上，但是还是每周活动。如果大家有问题，欢迎大家来提问，可以咨询如何参加。谢谢。
Yu Rong is the director of the Quenchy Workshop, and Quenchy Society offer classes every weekend in Flushing. And you can learn about singing aria, you can learn about movements and makeups, playing instruments like flutes. Right now, because of COVID-19, so everything can move online. If you want to learn Quenchy, feel free to get in touch with the Quenchy Society. You can check our chat. There will be some information available.
好，有观众朋友问到说，刚才我们片中谈到了这个冲和老师录制的昆曲十六首，所以想请问张冲和老师的录音跟曲谱有没有出版，在哪里能买？我想录音的部分我们请曲社的季芳老师替我们回答，因为季芳老师是安排当年这个昆曲十六首的录音工作的。至于曲谱的部分，我们等一等请陈安老师替我们回答。雅云。
Yeah, so there's also audience interested in the recording that we mentioned, that Chonghe recorded in 2004. So where can we get the album? And also there's questions about the...
See if we can move this so I can...
If there's any like notation by Chonghe, and where can people access to it? So I think Miss Ying is going to answer about the album.
就是这样的， 春花老师在2004年的时候录制的这昆曲16首是我们制作的，但是出版呢是由南京音像出版社 出版的，我们是出版过的。现在的大概留在市面上的不是很多，但是可以，如果有人还是要的话，可以集中起来告诉我们，我们可以再到苏州去看看还有没有，有的话就集中起来再处理。
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so the album was produced by Kunqu Society and was a collaborate with, I think, a label in Suzhou to publish the album. So if you want that album, let Kunqu Society know, because there's probably not a lot of copies around, but there's definitely ways to get in touch with the label company. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
是的，那么刚才还有朋友问到就是关于曲谱的问题，所以安娜老师能不能帮我们回答一下这个关于冲和老师出版的曲谱的情况怎么样？
Can we have Anna to talk about, because 冲和create the notation, so what about the publication of her notation?Yeah, Anna 老师，不好意思。
冲和老师的曲谱社在2012年出版了他的全套的，那是折子戏，就是一个一个的像小字帖一样的，一本一本。那个是在2012年出，现在。就在这我们这几天，他们上海慈书出版社要帮他出一个最新的新版的，就是只有一本，可是重新设计，非常美。我刚刚就在找我的这个些资料，我本来想要放在 Facebook 上，可是因为今天我们有这个大的节目，我想明天放，我明天会放出这些资料。他的原来2012年出版的书很贵，要好几百块人民币，现在要出版的这个就100多块，100多一点，可是非常漂亮，因为这个设计者花了心思去做的。我明天会放在这个曲社的这个 Facebook 上，所有的消息大家就可以开始订购了。
Mm-hmm.
So, back in 2012, there were a bunch of notation that was handwritten by Chong He, like the lyrics and the, you know, music notation. It was published back in 2012, and those were like little publication, you know, of different episodes. Those are really rare and expensive now, but the good news is there's going to be a new publication of the same content, but just combine everything coming out this year. So Anna is going to post something on her Facebook about this. So stay tuned tomorrow.
Mm-hmm. Actually, Yiling's background is with the first publication, the handwritten,music notes. It's the background with Yulin's. If you see that, that's from that book.
好，我们现在很高兴这个有新的一个出版，因为我也听说样书刚刚出来，这个真的是很精致很漂亮，虽然不像几年前的那个很古朴的做法，但是做得非常的精致，而且价钱非常的，不是非常，但是比较亲民，所以大家一起期待。好，下面还有观众的问题说，纪录片里面提到了冲和老师家里的录音受了损坏，不知道有没有修复的可能，很想多听到冲和老师的昆曲录音。这可能就要问问那个 Emma 跟怡燕了，看看他们家的这些这个老录音带现在情况如何？雅云帮我们问一下吧。
Sure, yeah. So the question is about, again, you know, people are fans of Chonghe's singing. And Ian and Emma, you mentioned there was this recording machine, right? You had at home, but unfortunately most of the tapes were disintegrated. But we really want to know if there's anything left, can anything be restored it, so there can be more recordings of Chonghe available.
Basically, when we cleaned out her home, we found the tapes and they were, what do you call it, dried out. They would, if you touch it, they would just break.
So yeah, they were.
It was nothing.
They were in very bad shape. There was no way to restore
like
them.
Brittle or what would you call it, dried out or.
Yeah.
It was very sad because there was so many of them and you couldn't even pull the tape out because it was just like turn like pieces
disintegrate, yeah, into dust.
It was not pretty.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Ian 跟 Emma 说很不幸的就是他们在整理妈妈的遗物的时候，所有的袋子就是连拉都拉不出来，就是都是脆脆的，一碰就断了，所以。没有什么东西
是
好，下面还有一个问题是 for Emma， 观众朋友们很想知道 Emma， 第一就是因为我们在视频里看到冲和老师给 Emma 写的曲谱公尺谱，所以有人想知道 Emma 是怎么学公尺谱的，现在还记得不记得？还有呢，还有人想说 Emma 现在还记不记得怎么唱，能不能唱两句给我们听？这个有点为难，但是我们至少可以问问 Emma 就是学习公尺谱的这个经验。
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so this question is for Emma. So in the video, we learned that Chonghe handmade the notation, right? The 曲谱 for you. And that's so beautiful. Can you tell us a little bit about how did you learn, you know, the Chinese style notation and the singing? Do you still remember any aria? And one of the requests is, if you want to, can you sing a little bit if you still remember?
No.
Yes.
No, every day. After school, for about an hour, she would teach me a phrase and we would repeat it until I learned it. And then in the morning, as I said in the video, while you know she was brushing my hair, I had hair down to my waist. So she would brush my hair every morning and I would practice what she taught me the day before. And then after school, we would just practice singing. And she did teach me how to, you know, read the music. I have one book left. I'm trying to find a video here, photograph. Yeah. So you can see it's in very bad shape. It's falling apart, but I've been carrying it around with me for 50 years. But no, I don't remember any, I wouldn't be able to sing it, sorry. The last time I performed was when I was 19, accompanying her at an ethnomusicology conference in Champaign-Urbana, Illinois.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Emma 说，就像在那个我们影片里面看到的，就是每天放学回家啊，妈妈跟她就会一起练习，她一句一句的教她。那时候她头发很长，长到腰部那边，那就是一边绑头发的时候，每天早上上学啊，他们也会一起练习。那妈妈有教她读公尺谱，但是就是唱啊。读啊，现在都因为有点太久了，就是其实都不记得了。他刚刚给我们看了一张手机上面的照片，就是妈妈给他做的公尺谱。那他随身带着，五十多年了，一直都带着。那就是当然磨损了很多，但是唱的 部分真的是太久了，他最后一次表演是他19岁的时候，所以很抱歉没有办法现在表演给大家看。
好，关于 Emma 跟怡燕，观众还有一个问题，就是他们很好奇冲和老师有没有带怡燕跟 Emma 回过苏州，他们对中国的印象怎么样？
So this question is also for Emma and Ian. We wanted to know whether you had visited Suzhou before with your mom and what was your impression?
No, I haven't been.
I have also.
We haven't visited.
Sorry.
We have not been, we have not visited.
Mm-hmm. 所以Emma 跟 Ian 两个都没有去过苏州，所以 yeah.
好，下面有两个问题是比较学术性的问题。第一个就是有观众朋友还是不太知道说昆曲跟京剧的不同。那第二是有一个朋友问到，他说关于这个昆曲，他说昆曲是用吴语唱的，那不知道昆曲社的表演专家，就是我们的注射艺术家，是吴语母语的，还是学了昆曲才唱吴语的？好，所以我想这两个题目呢，关于京剧跟昆曲的不同，我们就请曲社的社长，也是 Hunter College 戏剧系的教授张东新教授替我们回答。那至于后面这个问题，就是关于昆曲是用吴语唱的，那么老师们的表，老师是学了吴语然后唱昆曲，还是因为要唱昆曲才学吴语二？反正就是这个回事。好，那这部分可能我们请蔡清林老师为我们准备一下好吗？
Okay, so the first question is what is the differences between baking opera and 昆曲？ And this we'll ask Zhongxin to answer the question. He's also the professor of Hunter College Drama Department.
哎，大家好，有关于这个观众问到这个昆曲跟这个京剧的差别，刚才大家有听到那个，我就讲一点，就是在音乐上面，大家刚才也听到很多冲和老师吹的笛子，中国的传统戏曲有非常多样，有非常百种以上的各种不一样的剧种，他们一个很大的差别就是音乐。还有第二个就是刚才问的问题是语言，所以在昆曲里面以笛子来伴奏是非常特别，那当然还牵涉到笛子伴奏所产生出来昆曲非常有特色的曲调、水磨调、这个腔调，还有昆曲在表演上的特色，所以我会说在音乐上面昆曲的音乐，第二个是在昆曲的语言上面，那每一个中国的地方戏曲都有在音乐跟语言的特色，所以可以看每一个人的喜好，然后欣赏各式各样不一样的昆曲。那昆曲最后一个就是它的历史要比京剧要悠久了，昆曲从16世纪成型以后到现在已经有四五百年的历史了，那比较后期年轻的剧种。
东兴，我觉得你就直接用英文再说一次就好。
Yes, that's why.
I was about to ask you how you to do it. And so the question is about the difference between 京剧 and 昆曲. Then I think that I could explain it in three major differences. And one is in terms of the music style that throughout the video we saw underscoring of the music flute. So flute plays the main instrument in 昆曲, whereas in other genres, so traditional Chinese theater, there are other musical instruments. And then secondly, it's about the language. So there's an audience member asking about what kind of language is used in 昆曲. So I will say that for the teachers to answer. In 昆曲, we are using a more like an ancient form of Chinese dialect. So it's not really specifically tied to one specific region, but still it's very close to the Wu region in the Suzhou, Shanghai region. Whereas in other genres, the language is used in terms of the dialect and where they are coming from. And then that's, I think, language and music. I guess I would say these are the major differences to differentiate between the different forms of traditional Chinese theater.
嗯哼，谢谢东心。好，那另外一个问题东心已经点到了，就是关于昆曲使用的语言。因为昆曲用的语言，其实刚刚那位观众朋友说所谓的吴语，但是我想蔡老师可以跟我们更清楚地解释一下昆曲使用的语言，还有这些专业演员学习的时候，面对这个语言，这个中州韵的时候是怎么学习的。蔡老师，请你为帮我们回答这个问题。
嗯，好，好，那个刚才那个跟我提出一个问题是说昆曲的语言问题。
嗯，
实际上呢，昆曲的语言呢，念的是中州韵。那么我们说的吴语呢，就是只有小花脸才用的，这是昆曲的另外一个行当，丑角演员。才会用小，才会用到苏州话。那么丑角演员不单要学苏州话，还要学普通话、国语，还有什么呢？苏北话，还有香山话、无锡话，要讲很多很多的地方语言，就是昆曲丑角演员所必须要具备的。那么中州韵呢？我们昆曲的中州韵和京剧的中州韵呢，它有不同。我们的昆曲的中州韵呢，有南方音在里面，就所以所谓的南方音就是入声字。那么京剧呢，它是中州韵呢，它带着湖广韵在那儿，所以这是我京和昆的语言的不同的地方。OK。
嗯哼。
Since this is so academic, 东心 ，Do you want to?
Yes. Yes. Okay. Yes. So, thanks to Cai 老师的answer. So, the Cai 老师just pointed out that actually, in terms of professional training, that Cai 老师is a renowned performer of the clown role type. In order to play the clown role type, actually, he needs to learn the Wu dialect as well as other dialects in other regions of China, and then. In terms of this ancient language that's used in Kunqu, you could see the difference in terms of the rhyming and also the dialect use. It's different from Jingju, even though they are both like using like these heightened form of verse, but in terms of rhyming, they rhyme differently based on the historical period. So yes, we are getting to some very, very fine points into these different forms of traditional Chinese theater. That means that Chinese theater is really rich in terms of complexity and the differences. So if we know the dialects and languages, you could tell. So that's what I would say.
好，谢谢东心。OK， 好，那另外还有观众朋友想问的是关于笛子的问题。他们因为刚刚我们影片里有一大段是冲和老师用各种不同的材质去做笛子，所以有人想知道说，听过张冲和老师亲手制作的笛子的曲友或者老师们，用不同的材质，比方说塑料笛子，或者说铝制的。跟竹子的笛子的音色有很大的分别吗？安娜老师，你是不是安娜老师？可能是我们中间跟随冲和老师最长远，然后又常常跟冲和老师一起吹笛子的人。安娜老师，能不能解释一下，从你的经验里头，这些不同材质的笛子有没有很大的分别？你们在演出的时候用过这些塑料笛、这些铝管笛来吹奏吗？
So the next
每一种乐器它是不一样的。
The question is about the flute, especially those one made by Cho herself, because she experimented with different materials. So we wonder whether there's differences between the quality of music, right? Is there, one that you prefer to use for performances?
Mm-hmm.
Anna 老师。
这个中国的乐制在1950年左右是一个很大的 在音乐上非常重要的是，就是50年以前我们用的是笛子，传统的笛子来低音。中国从商周开始就是笛子来定音的，皇帝就是那个从皇帝开始是用笛子定音的。1950年完全把中国的这个所谓三分审一法，把它这种的传统的定音方法就取消了，现在的笛子跟1950年以前的笛子完全不同，因为它是用西方的钢琴的定调，
是
完全是 西方的钢琴的。
嗯，
所以现在我们如果要听1950年以前的这个于正飞他们的笛子，我们只能听他的腔，不能用他的笛子来做伴奏，因为音不准，跟现在的制度是不同的。我们是两种完全不同的这个制度。
嗯哼，好，这个问题东欣是不是请你简单的说一下。我想这个问题第一个就是说这个不同的材质是不同的，声音当然会有一点不同。那第二就是安娜老师提到说这个笛子的，因为我们现在是跟着西方的这个音律走，所以跟当年的比较古朴，就是我们的影片中听到的那个背景的笛子其实是有一点不一样的。
Right. So if you know Western musical scale, you'll notice that maybe you'll find some of the keys were a bit off tune that are in terms of Western, like musical scale. And so that's because that, as teacher Anna mentioned, that China went through some modernization of musical education. So looking into the Western musical scaling, and whereas Chong He Lao Shi, actually she still retain the more ancient form of separating the different notes. And so that there was this sharp difference. So in a way that it's really rare for Chong He Lao Shi to continue the traditional practice and to do that. And so that has this ancient sound. But if you want to match that with the current, this newer form of Western musical scale, probably it might be a bit off tune, but maybe that's the charm here that we can use this to appreciate that.
好，谢谢东西。我们还有一个问题是，有人是想知道冲和先生对于昆曲入选联合国非物质文化遗产这件事情有没有什么联系或者影响？那这个问题我不知道是不是尹老师知不知道？尹继芳老师，你知道一点儿这方面的事吗？
我可以回答。
So the question is,
因为我在联合国工作。
老师，我可能我先就是翻译一下。The question was the Kunshu was designated as UNESCO human oral intangible heritage. I can't remember the full name. Is Chonghe made any try to advocate for Kunshu in terms of that? 尹老师。Please answer.
安娜老师说。安娜老师。Because I work for the United Nations for 20 years, so I was retired from the 这个联合国。我知道联合国只跟非国家的，就是NGO 或者是联合国的会员国直接的沟通，不会跟任何个人和是私人的团体去做任何接触的，所以这件事情是传言，这是完全是中国自己向联合国提出的申请，是我们中国人自己提出的申请。
嗯哼。
跟杜华老师没关系。
嗯。
So Anna 老师 said usually UNESCO would get in touch with either the country or the NGO. They won't get in touch with any individuals on matters like that. So yeah, that was her answer. Yeah.
好，还有一个节目是有人想知道，就是请问有年轻人在昆曲社学习吗？他们参与了今天的活动吗？那我觉得这个问题，我们的昆曲社的艺术总监陈敏老师可以替我们回答。陈敏老师，请你解释一下昆曲社现在的学员的状况，还有我们的学习。
我们现在有很多年轻的学员，他们都很喜欢来上课，而且上课都是一个比一个兴高采烈。那么我们现在疫情期间呢，主要是礼拜六跟礼拜天在那个线上上课。那以前的时候呢，就是据说啊，我也不一定说的准确，九十年代包括2000年初期的时候呢，那个时候我们这儿的老师可能专业老师一个老师可能或者是两三个老师只有一个学生这个概念。那现在通过现在这么多年下来，现在不一样了，现在可能我们的老师开始不够了，可能一个老师要带五六个学生这样子。所以现在我们的年轻人是越来越多。那据我了解，今天晚上到这个线上来的我们年轻的朋友肯定是很多，相对可能要比我们的中年朋友老年朋友加起来的数量还要多，这是我的猜想啊，年轻人会很多。
So the question was, what's the trend of, passing down the Kunqu art? Is there, you know, still a lot of young people in this field? And Mr. Chen's answer is currently there's a lot of young members in the society. In the past, the trending might be there's more teacher than students, but now it's totally the opposite. And one thing for sure is tonight, there's a lot of young, either Kunqu Society's member or young people who are just Kunqu fans who are watching the program.
Mm-hmm. 好，还有一个问题是想请问海外昆曲社的老师们，如何才能培养出优秀的昆曲演员？哇，这个问题挺大的。吴德章老师是我们曲社的前任艺术总监，也是这个昆二班的高材生。德章老师能不能替我们的观众回答这个问题？
The question is, how do you nurture outstanding Kunqu performers? And Mr. Wu will answer the question.
我想这个学好昆曲啊，只要你有这个像张老师一样的心啊，有这么一个爱好的心啊，那么下苦功啊，像于正飞老师一样，他拍曲啊，一般一段曲子要唱300遍，所以这个以这个数量啊，就是能保证这个质量。那个唱曲要唱得多啊，才能熟练啊。第一个学昆曲就是要把唱要练好。
So the answer is practice. Yu Zhengfei, which is a very famous and prestigious Kunqu artist, has said when he learned one aria, 300, practice it 300 times, that's the least. The most important thing is, singing, you have to get the singing right. That's only the first step.
我想现在在我们昆曲社来学习的学生们很多， 他们好多的都学有所成啊，在舞台上也表演啊，这个跟他们自己下的功夫是分不开的。
So some of the Kunqu society member, they learn Kunqu and they also put a lot of time to practice Kunqu. And it's really because they, you know, spend so much time, so much effort, so, you know, they can do a really great presentation on stage. So the key is still practice.
好，各位朋友，我们今天现在已经是9:56了，大大超过我们预计要结束的时间了，所以我们今天真的是意犹未尽，但是不得不停在这儿了。还有观众朋友还有问题，我们鼓励你跟昆曲社联系，让昆曲社的老师跟学员们我们可以进一步的交流，因为有一些问题实在不是那么一句两句说得完的。那么请昆曲社的工作同仁把昆曲社的联系方式放在我们的聊天室里，让有兴趣的同学有兴趣的朋友跟我们联系。那么今天我们的节目就到现在结束，我们一定要在10:00前结束，然后祝大家健康平安，我们期待下一次可以在现场跟大家一起交流昆曲。
Yes, thank you so much for all of you, you know, spending your time with us today. You know, there's so many questions, we can't get to every single of them, and we, you know, thank you for your passion. Wanted to learn more about Kunqu or know more about Kunqu Society, you know, just get in touch with Kunqu Society. There should be information available in the live chat. You know, you can contact the Kunqu Society and then, you know, start to learn it. We wanted to thank everybody for being with us today, and we hope we can get together next time in person. We hope you have a good night or a good morning. Thank you so much.
Can I just say, I really appreciate all of the work that all of you have put into continuing the tradition of Kunqu, because I know my mother loved it so much. It was her heart, and she would be so proud of you. So thank you.
Thank you so much.
Emma 说她想要真的非常谢谢各位的努力，她的妈妈真的是非常非常喜欢昆曲，她非常感动，就是看到这么多人还这么努力为传承这个剧种做出的这些努力，她真的很感动。
谢谢大家，冲和老师撒了种，然后我们就继续在这个昆曲的花园里面茁壮，我们希望我们的花园可以更盛，更有更多昆曲的花朵盛开。那我们大家一起努力，欢迎大家继续关注昆曲，关注我们大家的节目，关注市政厅的节目。好，大家晚安。
Thank you so much. Bye bye.
再见，谢谢。
再见。
再见。
Bye everybody. Good to see everybody.
Good night.
Keep in touch.